There are too many distinguished guests here to recognize, but I would just like to say a special thank you, obviously, to the Mexican embassy for helping us to organize this, and in particular to our dear friend, Ambassador Eduardo Medina Mora. I'm not going to take very much time with the introduction, but I do want to say that it's a great honor to have Secretary Ildefonso Guajardo Villarreal with us today. As you know, he is the Secretary of the Economy in Mexico, but he has a long and distinguished career in the Mexican government, not only at the national level, but of course at the level of the government of Nuevo León. He has been Undersecretary of Tourism. He has been a senior official at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs from 1994 to 1997, obviously a crucial time when we're talking about North America. He has also studied internationally, and I think this is one of the crucial elements to understand about Secretary Guajardo's background, is that in addition to studying in Nuevo León, his bachelor's degree in economics, he has a master's degree from Arizona State University, where he was also a visiting professor, and he has a doctorate in public finance and economics from Pennsylvania University, so understands the benefits and the importance of an international education, and obviously understands at a very deep level the importance of the U.S.-Mexico bilateral relationship. We are here at a critical time in the U.S.-Mexico relationship and, of course, in terms of the economic future of North America. Mexico's reforms, which have been passed with such great fanfare over the past 18 months, 2 years, have brought Mexico up to a new level of economic competitiveness. And, of course, those reforms that we've seen in diverse areas feeds through into the regional competitiveness panorama. North America looks like a particularly or especially productive and competitive area at this moment in time. The integrated production systems that we're also familiar with make it a unique area in the world. The high levels of innovation that we see throughout the region and rising levels of innovation thanks to investments in research and design and in higher education. Low fuel costs, of course, being a crucial element of the region's competitiveness and a highly educated workforce. But we face enormous challenges still. It's been commented on many occasions that the three NAFTA nations need to invest much more in infrastructure, need to invest much more in making borders more seamless, investing a lot more in human capital and labor mobility to face the skills crunch or the skills gap and the human capital crunch which is coming to us. And of course, a particular problem right now is the sluggish world economy and low demand for exports. Given this complicated environment, we thought that it was a terrific opportunity to have with us Mexico's Minister, Secretary of the Economy, Ildefonso Guajardo. He's going to be talking about these issues as well as the broader issue of how U.S. and Mexico can compete in a very, very competitive global economy. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Secretary Ildefonso Guajardo.
I have asked for a mobile microphone because this room is kind of strange in terms of trying to communicate with those two sides at the same time. But let me start by thanking Duncan for this kind introduction, and also to congratulate him and the Wilson Woodruff Center for a fantastic event they sponsored in Mexico last week, where they honor three distinguished members of the U.S.-Mexican community, Carla Hills, Jaime Serra, and Claudio X. Gonzalez. Those three characters were honored last week as distinguished leaders in North America because they play a very important role more than 20 years ago. Carla was USTR at the time of the U.S.-Mexico-Canada negotiations. Jaime Serra was the Minister of Industry and Commerce of Mexico. And the only thing that Duncan didn't mention is that I live in this city for 7 years and I was part of the NAFTA negotiating team. Those were extremely exciting times. And back then, Ambassador Eduardo Medina Mora, who I thank for all the agenda he has built for me today, he was a big player in the private sector. He was part of the entrepreneurs that were the advisory group for the Mexican negotiating team. What happened 20 years ago, or more than 20 years ago, was a success story that started with a visionary attempt by two presidents and one prime minister to change the way things were done in international trade. How to pull together nations of different levels of development to integrate a free trade zone that was one of the biggest challenges at the time, because there was not a precedent of integrating a free trade zone like the one we were trying to create. And I think that when those type of projects come to mind, the vision of the leaders have to transcend party affiliations and political or myopic political positions, because at the end of the day, those are things that happen because of the strengths of society and the view of the entrepreneurial groups that are engaged. And NAFTA was possible because in the US, at least, you have a Republican president that was able to get this great vision of things and to commit to something that many were questioning at the time, and was able to really make this happen and finalize the negotiations between the three governments. But then, all of a sudden, there was a change in government, and a Democratic president came into power, Bill Clinton. And he was able and had the political skills to make NAFTA pass through Congress, even knowing that his own political party was not really looking at NAFTA with great expectancy. I mean, as we all know, the unions were not really cheering for NAFTA, and many other political groups in the US society, as always, were not very enthusiastic about free trade. But NAFTA did happen, and today, many of my friends that are here, that were big players back then, we can celebrate that the numbers not only finally show what we were able to build, but even some of those numbers surprised us because they went even further than we were expecting back then. I mean, most of this crowd know the numbers. Just to give you an example, every minute that goes by, we are trading $2 million between the three countries. There are 1 million crossings on the U.S. border every day. The effect and the impact of trade, Mexico is either the first or the second most important trading partner for more than 20 U.S. states. For Mexico, the geography of Mexico had changed radically in the last 20 years. At the end of the 80s, our exports were basically oil and minerals. We were exporting about 65% of oil and minerals, and only about 30-some percent of manufacturing. Today, Mexico is exporting 83% manufacturing and only 14% of gas and minerals. That has changed radically the way the industrial sector is developing in Mexico. And that means good-paying jobs, that means creating opportunities, and that means development. But at the same time, we have to recognize that when we were doing NAFTA, Mexico had the need to transform the legal framework that was the basis for the Mexican economy. And a lot of changes were made back then. To give you an example, in 1992, in preparation for NAFTA, we had to create our antitrust institutions in Mexico, and for the first time, we had to develop a competition law. Unfortunately, it started very weak. So for the last 20 years, we had markets that had not been highly competitive, and we have concentrations and monopolistic powers in some sectors, like the telecommunications sector, like the TV industry, like in many other areas, like even in the agro industry, flour and other commodities in Mexico. So just like we needed a good competitive system, antitrust system, we needed a very good energy sector that was not there. At the same time, our financial sector was not up to speed for what the economy needed to get financing. So for all those 20 years, and believe me, I was appointed, I was voted congressman in year 2000 for my party, and we struggled for 2 decades to try to get the reforms the country needed to be updated in terms of international trade and global integration. They did not happen for 20 years, not because of the lack of good economists or good technicians to design those changes. They did not happen because the political system was just getting used to the new waves of democratic competition and new elements of party balance that at the end of the day did not result in the changes society was demanding. Finally, after 20 years, we were able to get the political consensus from all political parties to really induce the country into a big transformation. The reforms that happened at the end of the day in energy, competition law, the financial sector, education, the fiscal reform, and obviously the labor reform that happened just in transition, all of them aim at only at many things, but as Minister of the Economy, what I look into them is that they aim at one thing, leveling the playing field between small and medium-sized business and big business. If you were a big company in Mexico, it is very easy to take advantage of this global integration. Because when you need financing, you go to global financial institutions. If you need energy, the former legal framework allowed you to produce your own energy at a lower cost that a small company gets from the state company of electricity. If you are a big company, you can negotiate with the big players in the telecommunications sector for lower cost of services. If you are a small company, you have to pay 35% higher than other companies in the market. So at the end of the day, the lack of speed and dynamics for all this success story to trickle down to small and medium-sized firms had been roadblocked by the fact that the legal framework was not in favor of this level playing, leveling the playing field for opportunities. So I would like you to think of these reforms, that they have many impacts, but there is one impact that has to transform the way we integrate production in our export sector. Today, the Mexican economy depends, when you divided our foreign trade to GDP, it's about 60%. So it's very easy to understand the role that foreign trade plays in the Mexican economy. Just to give you an example, in the crisis of 2008, the bounce back was quite quickly thanks to the strength of the Mexican financial system, but 100% of the bounce back of the economy was thanks to our export capacities and the growth of the export sector. Even today, when last year we have a very mediocre growth, 1.4%, now we're speeding up at a much better rate. We hope to end the year at around 2.7, close to 3%. And that is thanks to the export sector again, because when you look at the numbers, our manufacturing is growing at around 4.2%, and specifically the auto industry and the airspace industry is growing to rates around 6% per year. So we hope that the U.S. economy keeps in this very good positive track of growth, because that is highly linked. What it is telling you is that North America is deeply integrated as a region. And that's exactly the basis for the view that we have to have for the next 20 years in the North American strategies. When President Peña met with President Obama and the Prime Minister of Canada, one of the elements that have to be the basis of the basic view of the agenda was exactly to aim at lowering transaction cost in the way we produce in this region. You have to take into account that for every dollar that Mexico exports, there is almost 40% of U.S. content in every dollar. Therefore, the efficiency in which goods go across the border has a tremendous implication of our global cost for doing business. And therefore, if now North America is not only a free trade zone, but is an integrated production powerhouse in the world, we have to be mindful about cost of transaction across the borders. Back then, when we just started 20 years ago implementing NAFTA, the volume of trade was in such a way that lines were not that bad. Today, we're having a 21st century trade with a 19th century infrastructure on the border, because we need to invest in more ways to really modernize our facilities, to simplify custom procedures, to harmonize norms and standards. It is incredible that if you are an industrialist producing steel, you have to face different norms and regulations in each one of these three countries. If at the end of the day, we are building things together, most of these norms have to be standardized for all players in North America. And when you look at competition, when we started NAFTA, U.S., Mexico, and Canada had a 19% share of global exports in the world. Today, 20 years later, our share came down to 13%. So it's just telling you the big challenge that Asia is imposing in global competition. And if we do not put our act together for how to design the next 20 years, it's going to be very difficult to maintain this speed in terms of the success story that so far we have been enjoying today. All this said and done, you have to have also into account that the world is becoming a more protective environment. I don't have to tell you that the multilateral trading system, WTO, is going through very difficult times. The stance of India in terms of trade facilitation and the Bali agreements are at an impasse. And therefore, plurilateralism is taking over. We can like it or not, but it's a reality. Therefore, our trade policy as a region has to have a unified vision. If we are going to be out as North American partners negotiating TPP, if the US is out negotiating the transatlantic project, it will be a mistake if we do not look at us as a region, not as individual countries. Because at the end of the day, North American competitiveness depends on many factors that are complementary. The Mexican demographic bonus, the new sources of energy that will give North America energy strength and security for the future, and definitely the research innovation capacities that North America has built. If we play it strategically, we have the chance to become one of the most efficient and competitive regions of the world. If we mistakenly look for opinion polls, short-sighted political views, then we are destined to keep on failing what we are facing in world competition today. So I will leave my regards right here, my remarks. I'm sure that many of you have questions about the details of the reforms. I'm willing to share all of those with them. I will just point out that the fact that all political forces were able to come together and process this tremendous change in Mexican economic history by itself is highly valuable when most of the world countries are trying to reform. You can take the Japanese case, you can take any other attempts in the world that shows you that it's not easy to work through a political system. And the best example of this is energy reform was a taboo in Mexico, was something that nobody dared to change because of traditions. Even during NAFTA times, we were extremely protective of the state energy sector. And most of common sense in Mexico was telling you, do not dare to break this government monopoly, because Mexicans will come and protest on the streets because they have this strong feeling about ownership of oil. At the end of the day, all political forces debated energy reform in a very civilized way. It came out with a qualified majority of the lower and the upper house. And at the end of the day, of course, if you look at the opinion polls today, you will have shared views of how Mexicans feel about energy reform. But it is natural. Why? Because the longest they have to wait to feel the benefits in their pockets is exactly what it will take for them to change their opinion. At the moment, electricity cost comes lower because of the use of gas rather than combustolio. Yeah. it will have an effect in their economy. At the moment, cheaper gas becomes available to bring this energy to states that did not have the infrastructure for gas and new jobs are created, people will start changing their views on energy reform. So I don't have any doubts or questions or worries about the strength of this reform and its ability to maintain in time. Even with the efforts of the left trying to bring it to a referendum, you have to remember that every midterm election, you can take one question to this consulta popular, and today there are three questions being tabled by three different political parties, so we don't even know which question is going to be asked in this consulta popular. And at the end of the day, I'm sure that when that happens by the summer of next year, the benefits of the reform have had to become more evident to the average Mexican, so support can be erased. I will leave my comments here to thank you for this opportunity, and I will leave some room for questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. We have about 15 minutes for questions and answers. But before we move on to that, I'd like to recognize the arrival of our latest Wilson Fellow, Josefina Vasquez Mota, who is here with us. We bring people together here at the Wilson Center, as you can see. It's happened many times that people who never see each other in Mexico actually see each other here in Washington. But thank you very much for your excellent presentation, Mr. Secretary. We have a question over here. Oh, gosh, we have hands going up all over the place. Fantastic. So please, if you wouldn't mind introducing yourself, and then we will... Would you like to take one question at a time or three together? Three? Let's take three questions together.
Okay, hi. I'm Matt Schuhl from Inside U.S. Trade. Thanks for the opportunity. Mr. Secretary, I wanted to ask you about the Trans-Pacific Partnership as you're about to head over to Australia for the ministerial meeting. You've said previously that it is important that the U.S. and Japan reach a bilateral tariff agreement in order for the broader TPP to be concluded. So as you're here this week and meeting with U.S. officials, I just wonder, do you have any indication of whether the U.S. and Japan can reach that deal by the time of the ministerial meeting? And if not, what sort of progress could be made at this ministerial meeting if those two major players haven't resolved their disagreement?
Thank you. We'll take two more from this side of the room. Yes, one right there. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brian Wingfield with Bloomberg News. Mr. Guajardo, thank you for doing this. You mentioned that you'd like to see the U.S. and Mexico have stronger energy ties. I'm wondering if you think the U.S. should, or if you think it would help if the U.S. dropped its crude export ban, and if maybe not going that far, what should be done to increase those ties? Thanks.
Thank you. Did we have another question on this side? Yes.
Hi, my name is Eugenio Weigen. I'm from Tech de Monterrey, actually from Nuevo León as well. And I was wondering about the competitiveness in Mexico. The recent World Economic Forum places like four main challenges, which are labor efficiency, technological readiness, education, and security. All of them have a reform as a response, except security. So I'm wondering if you can mention a little bit what are the steps that are being taken that to improve security in Mexico and make it more competitive.
Okay, let me start with the question from the U.S. Trade, which is basically a very specialized media publication. As we speak, the U.S. negotiators are in Japan trying to break a deal on market access. It is clear for anybody that knows about trade negotiations that if these two big trading partners, Japan and the U.S., they do not come to an agreement, it has domino consequence on the rest of the 12 countries. Because most of these economies, like Australia, New Zealand, even Malaysia, are in the negotiation because of the expectations of a bigger market access. And this trade agreement, as has been the case, has been inspired by 20 years of experience of the U.S. negotiators. So you remember that NAFTA created for the first time the concepts of labor and environment in a trade agreement as a side agreement of NAFTA. Well, today, labor and environment are not side agreements for TPP. They are in TPP with the mechanisms for dispute resolution, are part of the agreement, just like they are applied to trading goods. They are also applied for sanctions of misbehaving in labor rights and environmental cases. That tells you that if Vietnam, Malaysia are in and are willing to accept these high standards for non-traditional trade issues, it's because they are expecting good market access. And if that is not clear at this point, then their willingness to work along the lines is less enthusiastic until they see at the end what is in for us if this market access. For Mexico, it's a different story because one of the big players already has a big, two of the big players, Canada and the US, they already have a free trade agreement with Mexico. So for Mexico, the only incognita or the only equation not solved is Japan. We have a bilateral with Japan, but that is has a lot of limitations, and we want through TPP to increase our market access to Japan. So at the end of the day, our trip to Australia, I met yesterday with Mike Froman. He wants us to advance as much as possible in everything else, regardless of the result of market access. As NAFTA partners, we are willing to work very closely with the US and Canada, and basically with the US in this strategy. But unfortunately, just by experience, I don't know how the rest of the countries are going to come to the table to bring alternatives to close everything else but market access. So I told Mike with all candor yesterday that I hope that we can have very good news out of Tokyo in these days. So it will really clear the path and the way to come to a close this year after our ministerial meeting in Sydney, and then be ready for the presidential meeting in China in the context of APEC. Now, the next question was Brian. The problem with these questions is that once you answer the first one, you forgot the second one. Now, you ask about security and the competitive index of the World Economic Forum. You are right, and you targeted right. This decrease in the competitive index of the World Economic Forum is highly related exactly why the reforms were needed, and they target the areas of reform that were accomplished. But when you mention there is not a reform in security, well, I think that we have to look at how things are being dealt with. First, there are reforms in the penal system, the way you homogenize the states with the federal level. That by itself is already a reform in the right direction for the judiciary to work effectively. Now, in terms of security itself, let me tell you that there have been plenty of actions in terms of trying to convince the states to have a one strong police at the state level, because it is impossible at the municipality level to have a police force of enough size and capacities to deal with the challenges of organized crime. So the best example I can give you is my own home state, Nuevo León, and you are from there. You remember the nightmare that we suffered like 4 years ago about security. And then Fuerza Civil, a new police corps, was created at the state level. And that diminished the dependency on the local city level police corps. And that had improved tremendously the performance in security in the city and reduce the criminal rates in the city. So that example is exactly what is happening everywhere else. Now, the Minister of the Interior has been sharing some numbers in terms of the statistics for kidnapping and other type of crimes that are derived or highly correlated with organized crime. And those numbers have improved. Obviously, I mean, the elephant in the room is what just happened in Guerrero. We have to be mindful that when you have 32 federal entities, the level of development is not the same in each one of them. Obviously, Michoacán, Guerrero, and in some lesser degree, Tamaulipas, are a big challenge. And we have to work very hard to bring to those people the same levels of trust and confidence that we enjoy in other states. It is quite interesting when you look at what is going on in terms of investment opportunities and business. Some international players are coming very strongly to invest in Guanajuato, Querétaro, Aguascalientes, Nuevo León, Chihuahua, because they have enough knowledge to know that Mexico is a mosaic and the conditions are differential between one place and another. Just in the first 20 months of President Peña, we have either announced or inaugurate or open new plans in the automotive and auto parts sectors for more than $10 billion of investment, with possibilities of creating 42,000 new jobs within the next 4 to 5 years. That is telling you that even investors discriminate or where do they go to invest in Mexico. Now, that being said, it is also very important that the efforts are evenly spread and really taken to a full extent to help these states that are going through terrible times, and they need to be part of the national effort to really change things deep down. These type of things, they don't help, and they distort, and they really damage the international image of Mexico.
Thank you. Sorry, would you mind repeating your question over there?
No, I think it's the third question, which is, it was Brian, yes.
Security. Energy security.
Yeah, with the, well, let me tell you that yesterday, one of the elements that is part of this framework is that what is going to be the challenge in TPP? When we negotiated NAFTA, I mean, I'm responding on the Mexican perspective of the issue. When we negotiated NAFTA, the U.S. and Mexico had a very clear agreement. We do not pressure you on migration, and you do not pressure us on energy. And so NAFTA came out with no type of arrangements in migration and energy. Things changed through time, and today Mexico has changed the legal framework behind energy. Therefore, there are elements in the U.S. law that require most favored nation treatment. And given the fact that now we open for the private sector, we cannot run the risk of not transforming that in order to give assurances for U.S. and Canadian investors within our NAFTA framework that has going to be transformed by TPP. Because if we don't do that, then we can be, in a way, in a difficult position with the supply of gas that at least for the first years is going to be fundamental until, I believe, at the end of 2015, we can get access to our own natural gas. So the first consequence of that is how we are going to adapt the new framework, legal framework for energy, and reflect that into what we are negotiating today in TPP. At the beginning of the negotiation, since we were just about to discuss energy reform, we completely excluded the charter. But at this point in time, we have to engage in analyzing how we are going to reflect the changes that happened in Mexico, because your legal system had retaliation when you don't have NMF treatment to the U.S. business community. So that will imply a big challenge on how do we adapt TPP at the end of the day in some of these areas.
So should the U.S. drop its
No, I'm not assuring that. This is the status quo today, and I have to just assume that that is part of, I mean, that those are decisions that the U.S. will take. But while you don't change that, I'm obliged to accommodate in the negotiation the way in which we can work together by transforming or reflecting in our new treatments or agreements the changes in the Mexican law.
Thank you. To maintain our nonpartisan basis bias or non-bias, let's take three questions from this side of the room. We have one, two, and then three. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Heidi Smith. I want to ask you a question about public finances and leverage some of your older history about public finances. I'm curious about, there's been some questions regarding not executing a sufficient amount of money currently by the executive agencies into the economy, that they're not spending sufficiently too much quickly enough, and there's been some estimated growth rates that haven't jived well with the public financing. And I'm curious about your perspective of that. And then also, the new framework, public finance framework, of leveraging more public-private partnerships at the state governments instead of using traditional transfers. And I'm curious of your perspective on why that would be a better angle for the Mexican economy.
Thank you. And the gentleman next to you.
Okay. Yes, hello. I'm Bjorn Arp from the firm Aparicio Arp & Associates here in Washington, D.C. My question further relates to or follows up to the security question, because I think that in further to the security issue, there are also other challenges for the rule of law in Mexico still pending, as just, for instance, the situation of Arturo Montiel demonstrates, who still after more than 3 years keeps his kidnapped children at home and is able to overcome the hurdles of the judiciary and can handle this sort of situation relatively well, in spite of the apparent separation of powers in Mexico. How do you think your government can improve these challenges to the rule of law in Mexico in order to generate more trust in the system?
Thank you. Okay. And the gentleman, yes, right there. Thank you.
The name of this fellow?
Senor Secretario. Steve Richer, I'm with the Tour Operator Association, and I was wondering if you could comment on the bilateral movement of visitors between the U.S. and Mexico, and whether it's reaching todos los estados in Mexico. And if you would comment on what you anticipate for international air traffic coming to the new airport in Estado de Mexico. Thank you.
I think that it is incredible, but 4 hours of flight apart sometimes has a lag in how we share information. Your concern about public spending was exactly the concern that was very strong in 2013. And part of the elements is how every 6 years, when there is a new administration, while you review the policy programs and you decide your strategy, there is a lag in public spending that reflects. Now, let me also make very sure that when you look at national accounts, public investment is just only a small part of the overall national accounts. But it is very indicative of the potential of growth and effectiveness of expenditure. That has changed dramatically. And today, that has now is the opposite. I think that the growth rate of public investment and social spending has been surpassed the numbers, and now we are on the other side, on the positive side. And the impact on the construction sector is evident, and what is going on today. When you look at the growth rate of the second, third quarters, now closing third quarter, they are improving quite fast. To the contrary, now there is a criticism that there is a deficit being considered for this fiscal year. But at the same time, the Minister of Finance was just in the city last week. But it's exactly the response of the criticism that public spending had never been used counter-cyclical. You can have the leverage to increase the deficit in the short term as long as economic players believe that you have the fiscal strength to finance that in the medium and long term. That's how contracyclical public policy works. And so that is the case happening at this moment. And I think that the worries about the economy has been, they have not disappeared, but they are less of a concern, thanks to the growth of the U.S. economy. I mean, as I was saying at the beginning, the future of the American economy has a tremendous influence through a trade relationship that represents 2/3 of our GDP. And that has a great impact. And public spending at this point in time is really pushing ahead in growth rates that are 2 digits in most of the areas at this point in time. You also asked about PPPs or Asociaciones Público-Privadas, which is the name of the law in Mexico. Well, I do remember that we were in Congress when that initiative came from the Senate. And what a better witness of what we did with Asociaciones Público-Privadas that yourself. You were the leader of PAN in Congress. And it was a big challenge because there was a lot of disbelief on the left side, on the PRD. And even within my own party, half of the congressmen did not like very much the instrument of PPPs or APPs. And we have to work very hard trying to build a coalition to get it through Congress. And finally, we were able to build a coalition of some congressmen from the left, most of the congressmen from PAN and from PRI. And we got it accomplished. And it was very important because for the first time, two very abstract instruments that were required to build this type of projects. In the past, if you wanted to build a hospital and provide this service to the government, you have to work with two legal frameworks, the one on public works and the one on hiring services. And you have to adjust to an unlimited list of requirements in terms of suppliers, cost, and a lot of accounting scrutiny. And today, with this new law, it's just one instrument that at the end of the day, the bidding is for the final service. So if I'm the government and I'm going to ask you to provide medical services for patients, what I will monitor is the final service that you are going to deliver. How you build the hospital, who do you buy the windows and doors and medical equipment is your problem. I'm just going to measure the quality and the cost of the final services, which is the framework that this new law is giving you. In the past, you have to go for a bidding to build the hospital, and the government will get involved into who are you buying the door from, and I will scrutinize cost of every nail in the building. And then I will go and go for a bidding for the service supply of the hospital, which will make a tremendous big bureaucratic effort and waste. So this time, this law simplifies the process, and it was thanks to the work that we did with all political parties involved. And it was an initiative that came from President Calderon, went to the Senate, was transformed and enriched, and finally approved in the lower house. How do you think the rule of law and the case of, you mentioned a case of Arturo Montiel and the children that he had. I think that most of what you have seen in the judiciary is aiming towards that in many different areas. But one thing is the key for a better judicial system to work in Mexico is transparency. I'll give you a good example in my field. The auto industry is one of the most successful industries in Mexico. We are exporter number 4 in the world. But in terms of capacity to produce, we are number 8. Why the difference between being number 8 in production capacity, or 8 or 7 now, because I think we surpassed Brazil now, and number 4 to export? So that difference is because our internal market is very weak. So we are very successfully in exports. We are producing more than 3 million cars a year, but very weak in the domestic market. Why? Because two things. We are getting a lot of junk through the border, with vehicles that do not meet environmental requirements and technical requirements, and because the financial market did not work for good financing. Why? Because the repo of a car will take you 6 months in Mexico, while in the US take you 72 hours. So the guarantees for the car industry are much lower, therefore financing plays a lower part in sales of cars. Why I'm telling you this story? When you look at the imports of what we call chatarra, there were two federal tribunals in Mexicali that were giving an amparo. Amparo, I don't know how you translate amparo in English, injunction, to allow some of these guys that trade in used cars from the US to Mexico to do not meet the requirements imposed by the government. There were thousands of cars that came through those amparos in Mexicali. At the end of the day, those judges were exposed, and the High Mexican Judiciary Tribunal ruled and basically put them into the spot in a process to discredit them and take away their positions. So at the end of the day, exposing them helped to really take control of something that was bleeding the Mexican car industry. So now we are working back into the terms of executing the Mexican authority monitoring restrictions to make sure that, free trade in used cars is in NAFTA. But as a country, I do not have to admit cars that do not comply with my own environmental standards. So this is a good example of how transparency and working deeply with the system to exposing judges that are not doing their job, it will help us to really improve the way we're doing things, together with the changes that are being processed through the system, like this is it the penal system? I'm not a lawyer. El sistema penal homogeneizado. Yeah, criminals, the criminal justice homogenization in the country. And then the third question was, airways. I think that one of the problems we have, you know that Mexico, besides this commitment with North America, President Peña has relaunched the relationship with Latin America. He just signed the trade and investment part of Alianza Pacifico in February, opening free trade with Colombia, Peru, Chile, and Mexico in a region that represents half of the trade of Latin America. One of the problems we have with Latin America is connectivity, is logistics, is how to improve the process in which we build things in the region. Is one of the regions less integrated in the world. The European Union is for instance, joint production. About 59% of what is produced in Europe is produced by inputs that come over across the countries. When you look at ASEAN in Asia, it's about 26%. Latin America is 18%. So it's a region that is not highly integrated. And the same happened with North America. Our logistic process, our connectivity, is very weak, and we have to improve that for trade. Big part of the cost of trading has to do with connectivity, infrastructure, and the capacity to move. In the case of the airport in Mexico City, it's a very good example. Most of the high-value merchandise that come into the electronic sector, they fly. They don't go by ship or any other way of transportation. Therefore, the capacity to really have an airport that can handle cargo is extremely important. And therefore, today, the infrastructure in Mexico City is not up to the standards that we require. Now, in terms of passengers, is fundamental, and the way we move people and merchandise in the region. And connectivity goes also through the understanding that all these natural bureaucratic trends of protecting your market at the end of the day have a high cost in every productive sector of the economy. Angel Gurria, Secretary General of OECD, just came out with a trade restrictive index. It is a very interesting index when you look at it. Very modern economies are in that index where we have not deregulated air transportation or land transportation. And the impact that that has in productivity of other sectors is very high. So you can see that in the Mexican case, the Secretary of Tourism and myself are every day on the back of the Minister of SCT asking him to open skies. Because you will get more tourists, you'll get cheaper ways to bring merchandise. Obviously, there is always this thing about the nationality of the airline companies, but there is a way to really open the skies and to really improve productiveness in all areas of the economy. And that's it, three.
Thank you so much, Mr. Secretary. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking Secretary Ildefonso Guajardo.
Thank you so much. Excellent.
That brings our event to a conclusion. We hope to see you again here at the Wilson Center very, very soon for more conversations about Mexico. Thank you for coming.